Tentor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Secret Machines, Book 1, Chasing Shadows, by Tom DeLonge and A.J. Hartley, narrated by Paul Costanzo. Forward. For as long as I can remember, I have sought answers. That search led me to the escape of music, expressing thoughts through my lyrics, voice, and guitar. But it was only one thread of the search. Time saw other paths emerging, as family, and businesses, and hobbies. But I found no challenge for that which was understood. I had a need to find answers to the unexplainable. Knowing that the odds of success were even less than that of a kid becoming a rock star. We humans are creation engines, both in thought and physical objects. When my thoughts are challenged by consistent unknowns, I need answers to allow me to see the effects of those unknowns, hoping one day to stumble upon a clue as to their source. UFOs became one of those journeys. UFOs, a vision consistent in mankind's journey from past to present, while evading explanation. We have pondered, what are those things in the night sky, whose movements defy gravity and explanation? Combine that with the physical world of mankind's amazing creations, harnessing science and technology to advance health, productivity, comfort, convenience, and security, to make answers that fall short of complete. And then there are the others that complicate the question. Fame hounds, lunatics, and intellectuals polluting the search with distractions. I knew, and know, there has to be an answer. And it will be a simple answer once we hear it. But right now, that answer evades our understanding. It is like trying to understand the description of a color we have never seen. As my search grew, opportunities arose. Some as a result of that search, but others by fortunate circumstance. And so, it was an unusual summer morning in 2015, when I got the call from an old friend who worked at one of the largest and most elite defense contractors in the United States. Even though he had recently retired, he told me for the first time his company was having an open house. A day when relatives of employees can come and celebrate with their significant others, husbands, wives, mothers, fathers, in what they do on any given day, under the guise of absolute secrecy. He asked me if I would be willing to introduce their lead executive, the head of their advanced programs division, the boss man, as I call him, to people who don't need to know the details of his identity, to the crowd. I instantly said yes, but said only if I can sit with him for a few minutes. I wasn't sure why I said that. I just knew that was an opportunity I needed to take advantage of. When the meeting came, I took the bull by the horns, and I pitched him an idea, mostly about a benign idea I had for a project that could help the youth lose their cynical views of the government and the Department of Defense. In many ways, Secret Machines was just that, and a few other things as well. The meeting went well, to say the least, and he said I could come up and give him more details at a second meeting. That next meeting was the time I entered four layers of security. Guns, electronic code entry systems, hallways with speakers lining nondescript ceilings, playing white noise so nobody could hear each other's conversations, and a series of solid doors flanking my view, each with rotary locks and not a single window in sight. Maybe because all that was out there was nothing. And that nothing was surrounding many miles of secret airspace directly above. By the time I got into the half-assed pitch, I had way more than I bargained for, including two top engineering executives of the company, and another who, unfortunately, had done quite a bit of research on me. I talked about a lot of things, but I did not talk about UFOs. I was smarter than that. The issue was, that exec knew that I was quite into that taboo subject. So she asked me point blank, what are your intentions with the conspiracy stuff? I tried to dodge the question, knowing I'd just been caught long before ever leaving the damn runway. And by the grace of God, I was saved by someone new walking in. The boss man decided to attend. I thanked him for coming. He looked to the side, then back to my fish-out-of-water eyes, and said, "We cannot be involved in any type of project whatsoever that has this topic associated with it. Specifically because there's never been any evidence whatsoever that this stuff even exists." I thought, holy shit, I'm in trouble. Were they monitoring my stress level? Did they know I was shitting my pants? I hadn't even pleaded my case yet. The only thing I could think to say at that exact moment was this. If Edgar Allan Mitchell, the sixth man to walk on the moon, is out telling every kid in the world that this topic is real, then we have a problem. But that's okay. We don't need to talk about this subject or include this information. We just need to address these credibility issues at some point. But give me your time, please, to hear me out. And then I went for a Hail Mary. "Sir, can I speak to you alone for 5 minutes?" Everybody looked around at each other, baffled. Then he said, "Sure." Now, I cannot tell you what I said to this man in that meeting, and I cannot tell you about the hour-long conversation I had with the other two executives right afterward. But I can say that over the next few months, things started to go light speed for this project. I was no longer alone to offer a vision, an inspiration, a piece of art to provoke one's mind with possibilities. After all, are these not the gifts of literature and film? I am here to tell you that an entire history of an unexplained and infamous myth, a legend, it's all true. It started to get very serious when I got an email by the boss man a few weeks later to meet next to the Pentagon at a certain day, at a certain time. He was going to introduce me to somebody who was connected. You see, I grew some balls and sent him the prologue that Peter Lavenda and I were working on for a series of nonfiction books, a thesis on certain elements within this project. And it seemed to have made quite the impression, because now I was on my way to meet others. I was scared when I entered the dark room. I had no idea whatsoever what I was walking into. I had no reason to be doing these types of things anyway. But I was ignited by a passion within that it was time to put myself out there a bit and accomplish something I believe is hugely important. I spoke for about 45 minutes straight, as a man stared across at me from a wooden table with squinty, learned eyes. He had a beard, a suit tired from a full day's work, and a hand gripping his adjacent wrist, a posture that seemed full of confidence. He really did look straight out of a spy movie, if you've ever seen one. After my speech, he watched me for a few seconds, then told me something I will never forget. "Things like this do not happen at the White House. They do not happen on the Hill. They happen at places like this, at tables like this, where a few men get together and decide to push the ball down the field." Meeting was over. Jesus Christ, my heart was beating again. How fucking cool. Cool, but real. I must remember to not lose sight of that. You see, I pitched a massive entertainment franchise that involved novels, feature films, nonfiction books, documentaries, and everything else that goes along with a story that's been told over decades and teaches people the truth about something that is almost too big to handle. I knew more than most that this phenomenon was scary, and everything that we did over the past 60 years was based on the enormity of the unbelievable task at hand. We had to rethink religion, history, national security, secrecy, physics, defense, space exploration, cosmology, humanity. But the generations of civilians who followed this matter felt left out, lied to, and disrespected. And truthfully, after I jumped into this project and learned what I have, I realized we were rightfully treated the way we were. We all would have done the exact same thing if instead we were chosen to deal with the extraordinary. But we weren't. Other brave men and women who came before us were, and they had to face the difficult consequences of such a reality. A reality demanding some type of strategy to comprehend and outwit. Not my words, but those of one of my advisors. I've had meetings in mysterious rooms far out in the desert. I've had meetings at the highest levels of NASA. I have had conversations at research centers, think tanks, and even on the phone connected to secret facilities. I've been introduced to a man whom I call the scientist, and another whom I call the general. And there are many more of whom I cannot say much about, but some have become true friends, and all have become close counselors. Each of these men has all held, or currently holds, the highest offices of the military and scientific elite. The point is, I have done it. I have assembled a team of men and women in the know, and they all believe I am doing something of value, something worth their time and yours. All along, I was never just another conspiracy theorist. So don't be naive and become one yourself. Don't regurgitate the same old alien tale. I was never immature about the matter, nor should you be. I respect the fact that it is a matter of national security, and I thoughtfully commiserate with the men and women dealing with what we could easily call the most important discoveries in mankind's brief history. I met A.J. Hartley on the phone first, but in person many more times over the past year. We had a lot to go over. I had to start from ground zero with him. He knew very little about the phenomenon. He was a distinguished Shakespeare professor, a New York Times best-selling author, British through and through, but most importantly, an open-minded skeptic. At the end of the day, he took in my madness with open arms, and together we created an architecture to level the playing field, once and for all. We have opened a door for you all to experience these topics in a way as if you were there yourself, which would, in all truth, be a frustratingly mind-blowing existence if you're not given the entirety of facts in one dose. A Shakespeare scholar and a rock star joined forces. Who would have thought? This first novel sets up many things, important events that had their genesis as far back as World War II, and continue today. The events, locations, and moments of wonder are all true. We weaved them together in a way that echoes what really happened to those who stumbled across something spectacular, wondrous, and a bit frightful. The glue is fiction. The building blocks are not. As earlier scientists, engineers, and leaders had to learn day by day, we will do the same with you. Once again, you will be given important information to live through, as though you were there yourself. And by design, we are not answering all the questions that may be posed. A lot of these answers will come in later books, over time. This subject is full of questions we've not been able to answer right away. Each event was studied closely, and sometimes it was painfully misunderstood and confusing at the time. There is just a lot more to the story than you and I could imagine, so we consciously tried to reflect that throughout the narrative, to give you time to digest and time to think back as to what may be what. So to all my passengers taking a ride into the land of secret machines, I have been granted the opportunity to tell you a story over a series of novels about the important events that happened over the past 60 years. These moments shaped our world in more ways than one. I know it seems unbelievable, but it's true. And this all started because on a whim, I asked the boss man if he could speak to me alone for 5 minutes. Remember, he said, "Sure." Well, this adventure may finish somewhere even more exciting. I recently asked another important individual if there is a possibility to get support from the White House itself for the truth to be expanded upon and communicated further within my project. And that man said, "Sure." Tom DeLonge, 2016. 1. Allen, Safedko, Central Afghanistan, September 2014. Major Allen Young checked the Harrier 2 Plus's heads-up display, put a few ounces of pressure on the throttle with his left hand, and adjusted the trim with his right thumb. Far below the Harrier, the arid mountains of Afghanistan's Hindu Kush range rose and fell away, invisible in the darkness as the plane banked to starboard. Deep in those mountains, a MARSOC team was already on the ground, working to secure an asset from a remote rebel base. Allen knew what he needed to know to complete his mission and was not interested in knowing more. It hadn't always been so, but he had learned the discipline of incuriosity, a gift, his old flight instructor had been fond of saying, that kept on giving. You don't need to understand the nail to be the hammer. How many times had Allen heard that? 100? 1,000? And he heard it now, felt it in his bones with the hard, cold certainty of truth beyond faith. He had his mission, which, God willing, would be uneventful, a routine patrol in support of ground operations. If it became anything more than routine, and when you're pulling 400 knots at altitude, nothing is truly routine, then something had gone wrong. Allen had been flying AV-8Bs, Harriers, for 8 years, three of them in Iraq, and the last two in Afghanistan, the culmination of his 12 years as a Marine. He'd flown dozens of sorties and never seen a bogey, but that was hardly surprising. The enemies he'd faced had no air power to speak of. It was their GBAD systems and shoulder-fired SAM missiles he had to watch out for, and overconfidence. But Allen had that under control. He'd let it out again once he'd returned to base. But until he was RTB, there was no place for that Top Gun swagger up here. In ancient Rome, he'd once read, a legionary who put the lives of his comrades in jeopardy through cowardice, stupidity, or some other disciplinary failure, would be beaten to death in front of his unit. That seemed about right. Unquestioning loyalty to your superiors and to your comrades, and the discipline to act upon it, regardless of the circumstances, was the frame, the purpose of your skills, your life. Allen Young happened to fly a $30 million airplane, but in his heart, he was simply a Marine. The lead forward air controller on the ground was Sergeant Barry Regis, a great bull of a man who had once, long ago when a world away, been the heart of an offensive line which had protected Allen when he had played quarterback for Monroe High back in North Carolina. Go Red Hawks. It was a long and deep friendship that crossed lines of class, color, rank, and branch of service. Regis was also a pilot, but, like other facts, he was serving a ground tour and seemed to have found his calling. He joked that he'd done so because he was too big to fit into the cockpit of all but the most luxuriant of aircraft. The Air Force wanted me, he once told Allen, but they would have had to slather me up with butter and jimmy me into the F-16s. He made squelching, oily sounds with his mouth and made a show of running his huge, dark hands over his body. There would be no jokes tonight, not until they were back at Camp Leatherneck. With Regis was a 12-man Marine Special Ops team with three objectives. Infiltrate the enemy base and eliminate all resistance by capturing or killing its leader. Locate and recover a pair of computer hard drives. And, most challenging of all, locate and extract a captured U.S. operative, alive. Even with all his emotions iced for flight, that last task left a knot in Allen's gut. It was hard enough getting a team into a secure facility, but to do so undetected, before some zealous insurgent could run back to a holding cell and put a bullet in the head of his captive, was next to impossible. The team had haloed in shortly after moonset, and had spent the last 3 hours making their approach on foot and in silence. The closer they got, the more dangerous it was. If they were detected even 30 seconds before they were in position, all that planning and preparation would be for nothing. Allen circled 20 kilometers from the LZ ready to throttle up at the first sign of trouble, but otherwise content to patrol the night sky, where the roar of his engines wouldn't alert enemy sentries, until Barry Regis called him in. In the Air Force, he might have flown strike missions, fly out, drop your ordnance, and fly back on schedule. But that was not how the Marines worked. Allen was flying tactical close air support, like the taxi rank Typhoons and Tempests called in to deal with stubborn Nazi armor at the end of World War II. You got close to the combat zone and waited for the call. It made Allen feel a little like one of the black buzzards back home in the sky above the woods of North Carolina, drifting aimlessly until the scent of death brought it swooping down. Regis's voice came in over the radio.
Black Eagle, you there? Copy that, Rattlesnake, said Allen. What's your status? 500 meters southwest of the facility. Still undetected. Insertion teams are performing final weapons checks. Closing in 2 mics. Roger that, Rattlesnake, said Allen. Be right there.
So saying, he tipped the Harrier hard to the port and squeezed the throttle, feeling the pressure on his head and chest as the plane leapt forward. As he re-entered level flight, Allen flicked on his fire control station and scrolled through the available munitions. The Harrier Mark II, as well as being unique in the Marine Air Force in its short takeoff and vertical landing capacity, could be armed with bombs, missiles, and guns suited for a variety of targets in the air, on the ground, or in water, and could rain down all manner of hurt on anyone unfortunate enough to find themselves in the pilot's sights. But you didn't carry bombs if you were going into a dogfight, and you didn't carry air-to-air missiles when there was no possibility of running into enemy air power. Civilians thought the Harrier, also capable of vertical takeoff, could also hover, hanging in place like a helicopter gunship over the battlefield. But it couldn't. You got in, high and at speed, and then you got out. Allen checked his navigation display. It was a moonless night. He was flying entirely on instruments, so that though he could sense the motion of the plane, it was weirdly directionless, something like being in an elevator. Intellectually, you know what's going on, and your body knows something is happening. But a part of you is still very slightly surprised when the door is open and you're on a different floor. Sometimes pilots flying in dense cloud cover or darkness emerged upside down, their senses baffled by the strange combination of solitude and sensory deprivation. Which is why you don't rely on your eyes when you have state-of-the-art computer systems to tell you when you're upside down. Old pilots romanticized the glory days of propellers and non-fly-by-wire mechanical controls and peering around to see if anything was about to blow you out of the sky. But Allen would take his APG-65 radar, his forward-looking infrared sensors, and his ANAAQ-28V lightning targeting pod. Thanks very much. He doubted he would need them tonight. When the MARSOC team was done, they were to be reclaimed, with their recovered human and technological assets, by 4 Nighthawks, 2 of which were MH-60L DAP models, packing the firepower of a battleship. The Rebel position, base was too grand a term, was a huddle of cinder block and mud brick buildings nestled on a mountain slope so steep it was nearly a cliff face. There was a warren of tunnels and caves beneath the buildings, a perfect place to hold prisoners and engage in secret meetings. It was too rugged and too remote to reach with serious armor, which meant the insurgents would have to rely on whatever weapons they could carry. There was a small tabletop plateau, about 100 meters from the compound, which would serve as an LZ for the Nighthawks. The enemy would be looking to make landing difficult, and that was where Allen came in. Dropping fast from 15,000 feet, the Harrier rode the night air like a dragon, all fire and peril. He was cruising at 300 knots and keeping the angle of bank to a minimum. But the Harrier was a notoriously finicky bird to fly, those wings requiring a firm hand and constant concentration, even when you weren't trying to direct the multi-nozzled exhaust ports. All jet fighters were fast,
but the Harrier was easier than most to lose track of. And if you got behind the aircraft, as the pilots said, you were lost. Alan mentally checked off the plane's available munitions. Paveway laser-guided bombs. A couple of AGM-65 Maverick air-to-ground missiles. Two heat-seeking sidewinders. And a 25mm cannon in a pod below the fuselage. It was a formidable arsenal. If he stopped to consider it, Alan might find a moment to pity those he was about to target. But it would not stay his trigger finger for even a fraction of a second. He had his orders. There were men on the ground who needed his support. He'd learned at his pre-flight briefing that the asset's name was Morat, a deep cover operative who'd been captured with classified information and technology on his person. He was being held, according to signals intelligence, at this remote location by an enemy who would soon spirit him away to a new location, where they would torture him for what he knew, then execute him. The strike team had been assembled hurriedly, in hope of getting Morat out before the enemy realized what they had stumbled upon. Both Sigint and Hummet indicated these were not goat herds turned half-assed freedom fighters, but seasoned Mujahideen. It would be a mistake to assume that they didn't know what they were doing. Even goat herds had cell phones and computers, and access to information and communication systems unimaginable only a few years ago. The billions of dollars of tech that kept his Harrier in the air didn't protect him from the terrible knowledge base, which was the Internet. "Black Eagle, this is Rattlesnake," said the radio. "Sentries eliminated. Team positioned to enter facility. No indication we've been detected. Lighting up LZG bad targets now." "Roger that, Rattlesnake," said Alan. "Black Eagle on course to engage. Stay clear of target." Alan dropped his heavy NVGs over his eyes and saw, ahead in the darkness, two infrared lasers, invisible to the naked human eye. He swung the Harrier hard to port, performing the hiccuping breathing pattern as he felt the aircraft pulling G's, then began his bombing run. 10 nautical miles to target. Alan shifted fractionally, squeezing out some of the tension that was building in his back, and performed a final systems check. Directly ahead, washed by the pale glow of starlight, he could just make out the cliffs of the rebel hideout. There were 3 points of non-infrared light on the ground. Fires. It had started. "Black Eagle, this is Rattlesnake. Enemy engaged. You are good to go." Distantly, hollowly, Alan could hear the flat rattle and crack of gunfire over the radio. "Roger that, Rattlesnake." The Falcon view from drone intel had shown a single sandbagged machine gun nest overlooking the LZ. It was quite possible that whatever troops were manning it had RPGs or shoulder-mounted rocket launchers, either SAMs or U.S.-made Stingers captured from Afghan Allied troops. As forward combat controller, Sergeant Regis, Rattlesnake, was Alan's eyes on the ground, targeting the emplacement with pinpoint accuracy. Alan came roaring in from the south, releasing his laser-guided bombs from 2 clicks out. "Ordnance away, Rattlesnake. Keep your head down." The explosions lit the night like a massive flare, but Alan paid no attention, lining up the Harrier for another run, waiting for word over the radio and checking his flyer for signs of movement in the combat zone. Nothing. The flash of the bomb had illuminated the sharp lines of the terrain, the cliffs with their warren of caves and surface buildings showing bright green geometric shapes through the night vision goggles. But moments later, it was all lost in fire and smoke and darkness. Alan waited, listening, feeling the pressure of his G-suit as he pulled the plane around. The radio crackled at last. "Nice hit, Black Eagle," said Regis's voice. "Target destroyed. That's an all clear for the recovery team." Alan permitted himself a sigh of relief. "Black Eagle to Rattlesnake and Dragonfly 6, he said. "Your LZ is secure. Repeat, LZ is secure." "Roger that, Black Eagle," said the lead helicopter pilot. "Helo 1, ETA in 12. Alan began to trace a lazy arc over the combat zone. Barring surprises, his work was done, though he couldn't relax until he was back at Camp Leatherneck. For the next 2 minutes, all was quiet below. Then the radio came back to life.
"Yeah, this is Rattlesnake," said Regis,
and Alan could hear the smile in his voice.
"We have the human asset. He's ready for a beer, but is otherwise in good shape. Enemy resistance has been reduced to nil. Still searching for technical asset."
"Good work, Rattlesnake," said Central Command.
"I'll watch your six until Dragonfly Six gets his ass over here," Alan added.
"Thanks for that, Black Eagle," said the helicopter pilot. "We are on schedule. Marsoc finished early. Not our fault if some people are a bit over-efficient. 9 minutes out."
"Beers are on you, Dragonfly Six," said Alan. "All good here."
But as soon as he said it, the radio spat again. CENTCOM again.
"Black Eagle, we have bogeys incoming from the northwest. 3 helos.
"From the northwest?"
"Come again, CENTCOM," said Alan with steely calm, thumbing his radar to air-to-air mode. "Helos from the northwest?"
"Confirmed," said CENTCOM. 10 clicks away.
"Looks like MI-35s. Could use your attention ASAP."
Alan could see them on his screen now, as CENTCOM ordered the helos to prepare to engage. His mind raced. The MI-35 was a variant of the Russian MI-24 attack helicopter, an updated version of an older aircraft used by a host of international powers. Though where they'd come from, Alan couldn't imagine. More troubling was how they had approached unseen. AWACS should have picked them up ages ago.
"Roger that," said Alan,
pulling the Harrier around onto an attack vector.
"Coming in hard, Dragonfly Six. Hold your position until we've cleared the LZ of hostiles. Any chance of getting those MH-60L daps in fast?"
"Still 6 minutes away," said the Nighthawk leader,
which was at least 4 minutes too long.
"Understood," said Alan. "Preparing to engage."
The hesitation was only fractional, but it spoke volumes.
"Roger that, Black Eagle," said the Nighthawk leader over the radio. "Show 'em who's boss."
He had maybe 70 seconds to determine who they were and what they were doing there. He checked his flyer, but the blips that had been there only moments before had gone.
"CENTCOM, this is Black Eagle. Bogey's no longer registering on air-to-air systems. Please advise."
Another momentary pause.
"Copy that, Black Eagle," said the voice over the radio.
It was carefully neutral, but Alan thought he heard a note of confusion, even alarm.
"Estimated time to intercept last known coordinates?"
50 seconds at current speed."
"Roger that, Black Eagle. Maintain course."
"You have them on radar, right?"
he pressed. A fractional hesitation.
"Negative, Black Eagle. We've lost them, too."
Which meant what? Some kind of stealth tech they hadn't anticipated? Back at Central Command, there would be shouting, earnest phone calls, analysts huddling around monitors. Alan ran through his weapon systems checklists, but he couldn't keep his mind entirely on the how of what would happen next. He hadn't expected this. No one had. The Taliban had no air power. ISIS had some captured Russian and Chinese and American equipment, but no training on how to use any of it. At last he checked, ISIS was in Afghanistan in token numbers. Alan scrolled through his munitions, thinking fast. And now the unidentified helicopters below him were back on Alan's flyer. 3 of them, exhaust ports belching heat. The one upside was since the Nighthawks weren't on hand, he could use his sidewinders, assuming there was enough heat coming off those enemy choppers for the missiles to grab onto. The radio crackled with static. The channel opened for a second, then closed again. The Harrier hurtled through the Afghan night. Intercept in 30 seconds. The radio came back to life.
"Black Eagle, this is CENTCOM. Green to engage. Repeat, engage all bogeys in LZ. Clear the area."
"Roger that, CENTCOM," said Alan.
He banked the Harrier hard to the port side, selecting a sidewinder missile, targeting the closest helicopter. Thumb over the release button. There was a brilliant flash of light, hot at the center and cooler at the edges,
but no sound of any explosion. Stranger still, the light did not dissipate. For a second, Alan was blind. He flipped his NVGs up, unsure if he'd fired without meaning to, or if he'd been fired upon. As his eyes grew accustomed to the glare, he saw that the light hung motionless, like a midday sun, perhaps 1 nautical mile to starboard. All 3 helicopters were suddenly, terribly visible in the light of whatever it was. As he circled, Alan could see them all clearly, hovering like great mosquitoes, suspended in the unnatural glow. Without another thought, he pressed the trigger button to release the first sidewinder. Nothing happened.
What the hell?
Alan pressed the trigger again, without result. He tried retargeting the system, but the missile wouldn't lock. He engaged the 25mm cannon and pointed the Harrier at the target. But when he pressed the trigger, there was silence. He stared in horror.
"Complete weapon systems failure," he said. "I cannot engage the helos. There's something out here jamming my electronics. Repeat, I cannot engage bogies. Rattlesnake, you have to get your men into cover. Dragonfly 6, LZ is not secure. Hold your position."
"Copy that, Black Eagle," said the Nighthawk leader. "But we can be there in 3 minutes.
"Too late."
"Negative," said Alan.
"Can you repeat that?"
said the helicopter pilot.
"Not sure I copy."
"I don't think your weapons will work any better than mine. There's something,"
Alan began, shielding his eyes from the orange-white glare of the sphere suspended to his right.
"None of my weapon systems are functioning. I have an unidentified bogey in visual range. CENTCOM, are you seeing this? Configuration unknown. I think..."
"I don't know," he managed.
His hand had developed a tremor, and he felt the unfamiliar tingle of panic.
"I think it's disrupting my weapon systems."
And then the unidentified helicopters swung away from him, angling to face the huddle of buildings that now cast hard shadows in the strange fiery light of the sphere.
"Bogies, locking on your position," Alan said. "Rattlesnake, get your people out!"
"Black Eagle, engage," said the voice of Central Command. "Fire all weapons immediately."
"Unable to comply," said Alan, overwhelmed with dull horror. "Systems down. I'm sorry. I just can't."
And then the missiles began raining down from the 3 enemy helicopters. And in the strange, terrible light that hung like an unholy star in the black Afghan sky, Alan saw it all. 2. Jennifer. Louvre, Swaziland, present day. Jennifer Quinn stared at the American woman in outraged disbelief.
"You can't do that," Jennifer said. "You are not allowed."
"I have spoken to the school principal, and he feels that it would be confusing to the girls," said Mavis. She wore a prim smile that Jennifer wanted to slap off her face.
"Confusing?"
she echoed, gripping the table edge until her knuckles went white.
"What is confusing about condoms?"
She slammed a foil packet onto the table between them. Mavis averted her eyes, but spoke in a maddeningly even tone.
"You are attempting to politicize this event," she said. "AIDS is political," Jennifer shot back. "Rape is political. Pressuring girls into marriage is political. It is not the place of peace and action to interfere with local custom and beliefs."
Jennifer gave a hollow laugh.
"This isn't about local customs. This is about your own prudishness," she shot back.
She was losing it, she knew, and it would only make things worse. But she could not hold back the anger that had been building up over the 6 weeks she had spent in Swaziland.
"This is about sex, Mavis. I know you don't want it to be, but it is. And refusing to talk about it is not helping anything. Hell, even the government knows it. When you cross the border from South Africa, there are boxes of free condoms at the customs and immigration checkpoints." "This event is supposed to be about female empowerment," Mavis returned, still placid. Still secure.
"Exactly," Jennifer shot back. "And that's not something you get with a few posters or girl power sing-alongs.
And it sure as hell isn't something you get reciting poems about our Lord and Savior. Peace in Action is not a religious organization, and you need to stop using social activism as an excuse to preach your damn beliefs.
Mavis's composure buckled.
You may think you are better than us, Miss Quinn, but I will not tolerate that kind of language in my office.
That kind of language? Exclaimed Jennifer.
We're trying to build a culture where girls don't get beaten into prostitution or die of every known STD on the planet, and you're offended by my language? You know what, Mavis? Fuck you and your holier-than-thou attitude. I don't think I'm better than anyone, but I am paying for this event, and we will not only give out condoms, we will demonstrate their correct use. So I suggest you go down to the market and buy a box of cucumbers. Hell, you can even eat one.
She knew as soon as she said it that something wasn't right. And not just because she'd finally called the poisonous old bitch on her sanctimony. Mavis smiled. Not her usual serene and beatific smile, mimicking the smile on the plaster saint that looked down on her desk, but a smile expressing something smaller and harder, a bitter satisfaction that was almost amusement.
Well, there's the thing, she said, sitting back.
Jennifer waited, but when Mavis said no more, prompted her.
What's the thing?
You say you are paying for this event, said Mavis. But that's not strictly true, is it? Your father in England is paying for the event.
Same difference, she said.
As it turns out, said Mavis, enjoying herself.
Not so much.
Why? What do you mean?
Mavis's smile widened, until she looked like one of the crocodiles sunning on the riverbank, not half a mile from where they now sat.
She fished a notepad from her drawer and made a point of consulting it.
Your father has terminated all fiscal support for this project, she said. I spoke to him personally, warning him that this might jeopardize your position here, since it has been, as I am sure you are aware, somewhat vexed.
And? Jennifer prompted again, keen to get this over.
Apparently, said Mavis, and believe me when I say that I really can't imagine why. He wants you to come home.
Jennifer marched away from the thatched hut and stopped, breathless, under a devil thorn in the gathering dusk, and released the tie around her chestnut ponytail, so that it broke in a ragged wave around her shoulders. She was wearing khaki shorts that left her long, tanned legs bare from thigh to calf, her feet encased in sturdy boots. She thumbed open another button of her sky-blue safari shirt and wafted the fabric, sweat running down her chest. Overhead, a flight of royal ibises rehearsed their raucous calls, and somewhere, she heard first, the roar of an automobile engine, and then the call of a hippo. Further down the road, she could see the children in their uniforms making their way home after school, chattering in Siswati, some of them laughing and jumping about, with the kind of childish delight she rarely saw in England these days. Her rage faltered, and she was struck with a sudden sadness that felt like failure. She snatched her cell phone from her pocket, then remembered she would have no signal out here. She would have to drive to Mbabane just to talk to her meddling father. The thought of the drive on narrow, uneven roads in twilight, pausing for cattle and warthogs in the road, and then his smooth, patronizing tones when she finally reached him, made her anger spike anew. This is so like him. She cursed loudly, a stream of furious invectives that made some of the kids down the road strain to hear what the funny white woman was shouting about. When she felt suitably chastened, she took a long breath, restored the ponytail to keep her hair out of her face, and climbed into the jeep.
3. Edward. Hampshire, England, present day. Edward Quinn placed the phone on the edge of his polished mahogany desk and considered it. She wouldn't call. Not yet, at least. Possibly not at all. He rubbed his face, feeling the jowly flesh move. He'd put on weight over the years. He didn't know when exactly. It had just happened, like a slow poisoning. All those years sitting in boardrooms,
eating foie gras and drinking port. He avoided mirrors now, not so much disgusted by his own swelling bulk as disappointed with the loss of who he once was. That was why Jennifer wouldn't call back. She could pontificate about the evils of capitalism, but he sensed in her lately less moral outrage and more of something simpler, a disappointment in him for not being the father she had once believed in. It used to make him angry, but now, slowing with age and afflicted by all the persistent little ailments that came with it, he felt only loss and sadness. It was time to do something about it. She had no right to be indignant, he reminded himself, lighting a cigar. She had been raised wanting for nothing and had been sent to the best possible schools, where she had flourished. He had given her everything. Too much, perhaps. It had all come so easily for her. And now, almost a decade clear of her Oxford graduation, she was still drifting from one Save the World project to another, without focus or any larger sense of purpose. Certainly she was smart, and strong, and clever. She worked tirelessly. He couldn't deny her that, pouring every ounce of her heart and soul into whatever she was doing, as if nothing on the planet was more important. But then she would read about a new endangered species, or a virulent disease, something that needed saving or preventing. And she would walk out and get on the next plane to South America or Africa. She could do so because he made sure she could, providing her with a constant stream of funds from the various businesses he owned, money she so despised. He had never thought her a hypocrite, but he would be lying if he didn't say that there were times when he thought that she had also disappointed him. She had so much talent, so much energy and resourcefulness, scattered like crumbs before pigeons. But dwelling on it would avail him nothing. Quinn turned to his desktop computer and accessed his protected files with a series of complex passcodes. Protected, the hackers he had hired to break in had remarked. That was an understatement. He had employed a deep encryption system based on lattice reduction and other forms of asymmetrical algorithms, linked in chains, and separately coded by independent operators, none of whom knew what the rest were doing. It was, he was confident, more secure than the Bank of England, the British government, and MI5 combined, which was just as well, because leaking the contents of his hard drive to the press would bring all three down at a stroke. He scanned his accounts, hundreds of millions of pounds, billions. His investments were solid, like continents, great sprawling rafts of money spreading from one side of the earth to the other, sustaining much of what lived on the surface. But from time to time, the entire mass would buckle in a great tectonic shift, erupting and reforming in ways that changed the world. Today would be one of those days. Continents moved at their own pace, according to their own rules. Money, for all its chaotic energy, could, with a firm hand, be made to do what you told it. Edward Quinn had such a hand and could, with a few keystrokes, alter the fate of the entire planet. This had been true for a long time. He had known what his money was capable of doing for 20 years or more, without it unsettling him unduly. But then Anne, his wife, his one true love, his confidant in all he could safely share, had started losing weight and suffering from inexplicable fevers. Non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, the doctors had told him. He hadn't known what the words meant, a fact that shocked him almost as badly as the diagnosis itself. So he had learned everything there was to learn about non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, because that was how Edward Quinn met adversity, with knowledge and expertise, and, of course, with money. He'd learned to speak fluently about B-cells, and to nod with understanding when his consultants used words like immunoblastic or lymphoplasmacytic. And he'd written checks that would have paid off the national debt of small nations. None of it helped. After a struggle lasting 2 years,
the girl he had first met half a century ago, collecting shells on Brighton Beach. His sweet, beautiful, perfect Annie was gone. Edward was left with a rambling mansion full of servants whose names he didn't know, and a daughter who never called, except to ask for money for some new cause. There was more, of course. More stuff. More things. More money. None of it seemed to matter much. There was his work, of course. Not the corporations on whose boards he sat. The companies who listed him on their mastheads. His real work. But lately, even that had started to trouble him. He lay awake most nights now, thinking, remembering, regretting. Something had to change. The board wouldn't like it, and it was going to be the hardest battle he had ever fought, which was saying more than most people would ever know. But it had to be done. It was time. Jennifer would help. Maybe not consciously or deliberately. He might not be able to tell her everything until the worst of it was over. But her presence at his side would make all the difference. That, too, would be a battle. But if Edward Quinn couldn't wrangle his own daughter, it really was time for him to, what did the Americans say? Hang it up? Something like that. She would understand, eventually. He was almost sure of that. After all, the work had been good once. They had lost control of it, allowed it to turn into other things. But it had been good at the start. He still believed that. Sometimes it was the only thing keeping him going. There had been that one day, when she was small, when she had come into this very room and found him studying what he thought of simply as the project. There had been a chart on the wall that she should not have seen. She had stood in the doorway, a little girl of 9 or 10, staring, her head cocked to one side, trying to make sense of what she was looking at before he whisked it away. He wondered if she remembered. Perhaps. It was time to show her the rest. The intercom buzzed. Yes, he said. Your helicopter is approaching, sir, said Deacon, Quinn's private secretary cum butler. Quinn checked his Roger Dubuis watch, a spectacularly expensive piece he liked because he could see all the inner workings through its silicon casing, and sighed. It was a 37-minute flight to the office in central London. I'll be right there, he said. He looked at the framed photograph of Annie and Jennifer on the corner of the desk, the two of them in shorts and T-shirts, after some mother-daughter 10K, both holding their medals and beaming. He had only put it there last week, after a lifetime keeping work and home as far apart as was possible. Too late, perhaps. Certainly for Annie, though he felt in his bones that she would approve of what he was about to do. Quinn logged off and shut down his computer. He had just shut his briefcase when he heard the door snap closed behind him. He hadn't heard it open. Quinn was surprised when he turned. The figure in the doorway was pointing a long-barreled pistol at him.
You? He gasped.
Hello, Edward.
How did you get in?
I'm good at getting into places people don't want me to. You ought to know that.
And you like to keep things between friends, said Quinn, though the gun doesn't look especially friendly.
I wasn't planning to use it.
Then why do you have it? Said Quinn.
If it becomes necessary, I'll use it, but I thought you jumping out the window would be more poetic.
Quinn glanced to where the smoked, bulletproof French windows opened onto the balcony. It was only a 4-story drop, but it would achieve the results his visitor seemed to want.
And what makes you think I would do that?
He asked. The visitor moved to the desk and, eyes still on Quinn, turned the pistol onto the photograph of Jennifer and Dan. Quinn's composure evaporated. He was dead, he knew, but he would not give up his daughter.
If you touch Jennifer, he began.
You'll what?
Asked the visitor.
Why would you hurt her?
Quinn asked, hating the crack of desperation that snuck into his voice.
This has nothing to do with her.
Exactly, and I'd like to keep it that way.
and if you sign this little note I have prepared for you, and then step off your very fine balcony, that's how things will stay."
The visitor placed a single sheet of paper, a suicide note written in flowing blue-black ink. Quinn glanced at it, admiring how it was meticulously forged, with what looked like his own Cartier fountain pen, in his own hand. They were always so careful.
"What assurance do I have that if I do as you say, you won't kill her anyway?"
"Why would I? As you say, this has nothing to do with her. She's merely a bargaining chip. Something that gives me an edge in negotiating. You, of all people, should respect that."
Quinn let go of the attaché case and considered the window. In the same moment, the intercom came back to life.
"The helicopter is here, sir," said Deacon.
The visitor raised the pistol to shoulder height and was sighting down the barrel into Quinn's face. Edward gave a fractional nod.
"I'll be right down," he said.
He signed the letter. As he sat back again, he knocked over the little wooden lion Jennifer had given him for Christmas when she was 10. He considered it for a moment, then put it carefully down, pausing only to pick up the photograph of his wife and daughter, which he clutched to his heart with a surge of sadness. He stepped toward the window. He opened the French windows and stepped out into the English air, damp and cool, gazing down at the mansion's gravel forecourt below, wreathed in a mist that was almost rain. He did not look back toward the visitor with the pistol, or down to where his broken body would soon be found by a shrieking maid, but instead gazed out into the gray air, seeing nothing. His hands gripped the photograph, and as he stepped up onto the ornamental balustrade, he whispered to them,
"Sorry. I tried. Too late, I'm afraid. But I tried."
4. Tamika, New York, present day. It was typical. Of course, traffic would be bumper to bumper on a morning when she had a Skype interview from the office first thing. Tamika eyed her fuel gauge uneasily.
"Don't give up on me now," she warned Dion's moldering Corolla.
The car had taken to burning oil at twice the usual rate, blowing out great clouds of blue acrid smoke behind her.
"You've got to get that POS fixed," she had told Dion the night before. "It's going to die and leave me freezing by the curb."
"If it's such a piece of shit car," Dion shot back, "why not take the subway like everybody else? Yeah, God forbid you should break out your wallet for anything you can't stick in your PlayStation,"
Tamika had shot back, staring her boyfriend down until he wilted and his eyes slid back to the TV.
"That's what I figured."
They were supposed to be going to Atlantic City for the weekend. Her idea. She'd pick him up after work, and they'd be on the road by 6, assuming that the car survived the day. If it didn't, or something else happened to screw up their trip, and if she got the message that Dion was relieved, things were going to go downhill in their Mount Kisco apartment faster than the crappy little car was ever likely to manage. The Corolla sputtered, stalling. She gave it a little more gas, watching in the rearview mirror as another cloud of black smog plumed out behind her.
"Jesus, lady," said the cab driver who was sitting alongside through his window. "What are you burning in there, napalm?"
"That's hilarious," she spat back. "You should be on stage."
He made a face, and Tamika urged the Corolla forward a few feet so she wouldn't have to look at him. On the west side of Union Square, she saw blue lights flashing. In front of a cafe, the sidewalk had been partly cordoned off with yellow crime scene tape. A pair of uniformed police officers were standing around doing nothing, as far as she could see. The traffic slowed to a crawl so that drivers could rubberneck, but there was nothing to see. She leaned across to the passenger side, brandishing the ID in her wallet.
"What's going on here?"
she called to the closest cop as she crawled by. He stooped to look into the car and rolled his eyes.
"Figured it would be you, Mars," he said. "At the precinct, they call you the question girl. I can't think why."
"Well, thinking was never your strong suit," she replied.
His name was Officer James Brown. And boy, hadn't she given him a hard time for that in high school. His phone number was still on her contact list, from which she'd organized their 10th reunion. "Hey, Jimmy boy, you feel good? Like you knew you would." Still funny. "Old guy got mugged," said Brown. "Your crackpot website got a crime beat now?" "Just a concerned citizen," she said. "He okay?" "You'll have to ask St. Peter," said the cop. Another comedian. "Here? At this time of day?" "Another beautiful day in the Big Apple. You want to move up? You're holding up traffic." "Yeah, I'm the one holding up traffic," Tamika returned. "You want to get these cars moving? Some of us have to get to work." The cop just rolled his eyes and shrugged. "What am I supposed to do about it?" "Yeah," Tamika growled back. "That's what I figured." She drove to the parking garage on East 16th Street and swung by an ATM to pick up the $500 that was her share of the rent. 5 minutes later, she was tearing up the stairs to her office, shedding her jacket as she ran up the stairs. The office was a couple of tiny rooms above a vegetarian restaurant, next to the classical facade of the New York Film Academy on 17th Street. It was cheap and functional, an address that hinted at prosperity, seriousness, and class. It also meant that she was able to include, on her website, a shot of the Union Square subway entrance, with a shallow dome and hat-brim ring that made it look like a classic flying saucer. Tamika bypassed the coffee pot with an effort of will and settled in front of the computer monitor in the one corner of the office that looked like an office, as opposed to one of those crazy lady apartments where no one throws anything away, and the cops only go in when the corpse smell alerts the neighbors. It was the professional corner, the Skype corner. She checked her appearance on her webcam. She was wearing her brassiest wig for maximum effect, a mop of glossy ringlets flecked preposterously with gold. Her business card read, "Tamika Mars, freelance investigative journalist and blogger." She was also the host of debunction.com, a podcast and website dedicated to exposing and ridiculing urban myths, pseudoscience, conspiracy theories of all kinds, and what Tamika grouped together as mainstream superstition. She had pages on everything from the Loch Ness Monster and the JFK assassination to miraculous statues of the Virgin Mary in Mexico. Though she wasn't getting rich off it, the site was one of the most visited of its kind, and the advertising revenue was steady. The Huffington Post interview she was about to do would surely boost her visibility. Her staff was a part-time tech support guy called Marvin, whose brilliance with computers was matched only by the amount of weed he smoked, and Audrey Stanhope, who Tamika likened to both a bloodhound and a pit bull when it came to sniffing out and chasing down stories. The metaphor worked, Tamika thought, because she could also be a royal bitch when it came to negotiating with advertisers. "God damn it," she muttered. The wig looked fabulously outrageous, but she had a coffee stain on her sweater. She was already 2 minutes late for the interview and didn't have time to rinse it out. She pulled a detachable fur collar off her scarlet coat and arranged it around her neck, trying to decide if it worked as some kind of quirky fashion statement. It looked like a pair of weasels were mating on her shoulders, but it covered the stain. Oh, what the hell? She logged into her Skype account and waited for the call to come through, scanning her email on a second computer for links to various news stories, one featuring blurry pictures of Bigfoot, another showing some suspiciously two-dimensional English fairies, and a brace of other idiotic stories, too obviously faked to merit debunction. That was what she called it, a ludicrous, bombastic, and eye-catching word that had become her trademarked website title, something sure to come up in the imminent HuffPo interview. The interview began well. The host, a perky but shrewd-looking blonde woman named Nicole, lofted softball questions, and Tamika knocked them out of the park. "How long have you been running the site? What was the first case you wrote about? Tell us about some of the more elaborate hoaxes you've uncovered. Why do you think people are so quick to believe in plausible things?" Tamika was calm and confident. 2.5 years. the Essex crop circles, which turned out to be the work of two drunk teenaged boys using a tractor and some towable farm gear. Well, there was the time the bankrupt owner of a Virginia lighthouse wanted to draw tourists by inventing a series of ghostly apparitions. I'm telling you, Nicole, this thing read like the script for a Scooby-Doo episode. And he would have gotten away with it, too, if it weren't for us meddling kids. It was only the last question. Why people want to believe in things that obviously aren't real, that gave her pause. Tamika trotted out some familiar ideas about why people who live boring lives are drawn to mystery and conspiracy. And then Nicole, hinting at a bitterness she hadn't shown thus far, asked how Tamika felt about spending her life destroying other people's harmless fantasies. Tamika paused for just a fraction of a second, adjusting to the unexpected jab, then answered. She said she felt fine about it, thank you, Nicole. She added that some of the things people believed in weren't harmless at all, and some were quite possibly dangerous, and that even harmless delusions were manifestations of a larger culture that had reduced science and objectivity to a kind of he-said-she-said debate, in which no one's personal authority or credibility was valued above anyone else's. The opinion of an eminent physician, archaeologist, or environmental scientist was worth no more than that of anyone with access to a Twitter account, and sometimes the opinions of accomplished scientists carried less weight than those people who were famous models or athletes or actors on a sitcom. Nicole seemed satisfied with Tamika's answer. In hindsight, Tamika felt the woman was attempting to goad her into saying more, because it made for better footage, not because she disagreed with her. Even so, she was rattled at the end, and when the interviewer wrapped things up with, "And can I just say that I love your hair in that fur drape? So fun!" Tamika wasn't sure if she was being mocked. "Guess we'll see when it goes live," she thought. Welcome to life in the spotlight. Well, if it brought in some more revenue, it was worth it. She didn't need the Huffington Post's endorsement to know she was doing good, necessary work. She was glad they'd asked her. Why do you do this? It forced her to answer it for herself, something she hadn't really done before. She approached the day's work with a new buoyancy, but even Audrey's whining about her sorry personal life and how the people at Fox News got paid more than she did could not dampen. "What's that thing around your neck?" Marvin had finally shown up and was peering at her, leaning with one hand on her desk like he wasn't sure of his balance. Tamika snatched the fur off and tossed it onto her jacket. "Nothing," she said. "I was covering a stain." "Right," said Marvin, nodding with greater seriousness than the remark justified. "Got it." Tamika wrinkled her nose. "You stoned man, because I told you about coming to work like that." "No, no," said Marvin, dropping into a bizarre half-crouch and putting his hands up in a half-assed surrender pose, as he always did when he felt threatened. "Swear to God, it's just, you know, passive."
"Passive?"
"Yeah, my roommate had the bong going this morning, and I may have caught some of the collateral vibe, you know?"
Tamika gave him a dubious frown.
"You up to installing the new firewall?" she asked. "Totally," said Marvin. "Well, within my powers. I'll have it done before you can say firewall."
He paused, reflecting upon this.
"But you might not want to say it for, like, 2 hours.
"Deal," Tamika said.
"Oh, and there's a package for you,"
he added, producing something about the size of a shoebox, wrapped in brown paper and tied with thin twine.
"The doorman just handed it to me. He said an old guy came by before you got in."
He placed the parcel on Tamika's desk. Her name was written in unsteady block capitals and magic marker. There was no return address or sign that it had been through the post. Not everyone was a fan of what the office produced. She usually received belligerent explanations in the mail rather than actual hate mail. But she'd had her share of death threats from people angry because she'd picked apart or ridiculed the assumptions they considered true or even sacred. She held the package gingerly, weighing it. Too light for a bomb, she thought.
but not for anthrax, or ricin, or, more likely, talcum powder, which would shut the office down until they could get an all-clear from the health department. "I'm going to open this outside," she said, fishing scissors and rubber gloves from her desk drawer. "You want me to come with?" Marvin asked. Audrey, Tamika noted, was making no such offer, and eyed the parcel warily. "Nah, I'm good," she answered. "If I'm not back in 5 minutes, call in the hazmat team." Marvin looked unsure. "Is the number in your Rolodex thingy?" he asked. "I was kidding, Marvin," said Tamika, picking up the package and stalking out of the room with a pointed look at Audrey. "Hey," said the reporter, with a better version of Marvin's hands-up defensive gesture. "I just work here. You don't pay me enough to get blown up." "Yeah," muttered Tamika, as she pushed through the door and into the stairwell, drawing her scarlet raincoat tight to her body. "That's what I figured." She didn't really believe the package was dangerous, but she crossed to the square across the street and chose a bench away from two old people who were exercising their dogs. She opened the parcel carefully, donning the rubber gloves and slitting the paper, then turning the box upside down at arm's length. No telltale white powder trickled out. When she lifted the lid, she found only a notebook. It was blue, hard-bound, with a cloth cover stained with age and use. Inside the cover was an envelope, thick with heavy stationery covered in spidery script. "Dear Miss Mars," the letter began, "I hope to be talking you through the contents of this book in person, since there is much to be explained. But in case I am not able to, I wanted you to understand something. The contents of this book are extremely important. I am confident that it will change your life and your sense of many things. It is also extremely dangerous. There are people who would kill me to prevent you from reading it, and may attempt to kill you for doing so. For that, I apologize. I will trust your judgment as to whether you will take that risk, though I am confident in my regard for your sense of ethical responsibility. Read. Investigate all I have to say. Check it. Subject it to your most rigorous debunction. Then call me. My time is short, even if no one tries to make it shorter. Until then, I am sincerely yours, Jersey Aaron Stern." His name was followed by a phone number. Tamika wasn't sure what to make of it. It screamed conspiracy theory nonsense, especially the paranoid hinting about lives in danger, which was one of the major hallmarks of the genre. But the writing itself gave her pause. It was an old man's writing, unsteady, but sophisticated, as was the phrasing. Most of what she received was a train wreck of small and capital letters, third-grade spelling, and text message punctuation. This felt different. She opened the notebook, carefully, feeling its age, and startled to find that it contained more of the same longhand script, though the penmanship looked younger, more confident than the letter she'd just read. There were pages and pages of it, occasionally broken by little sketches and diagrams. It was clearly a journal, all entries carefully dated. She flipped to the front and caught her breath. The first entry, laid out in blue ink, the desiccated pages stained and smeared with dirt, or even old blood, was labeled Krakow, Poland, 1939. No way. "You okay there, Tamika?" She looked up to find Marvin standing over her. "You look kind of spooked. You need me to call those hazmat guys or something?" She hesitated, staring at the first entry. "You know what, Marvin?" she said at last. "I'm really not sure."
5. Jersey. Krakow, Poland, September 1939. That date marks where it started. I am writing this entry a decade later, in America, and, as you can see, in English. I will write more from here as it happens.
but my story begins before what I think of as the present. So I'm going back to my childhood in Poland. That, as I say, was when things started, though I did not know it at the time. I was 10 years old when the Nazis came. Some of my family had already fled, but most did not go far enough. They went to other parts of Europe, and the war eventually overtook them. I was told I had an uncle who made it to England, and a cousin who set out for America, though I do not know if she made it all the way. I lost touch with them, as I lost touch with all my family. As far as I know, I am the only one who survived. I remember the first days of the war only vaguely, and my memories are confused by things I read or saw later. I know that the day before the fighting started, I sat with a Polish soldier, a little man who smiled at me and ruffled my hair. He was the driver of a kind of little tank. It had a machine gun, and it seemed to me that it was the greatest, most terrible weapon imaginable. I do not know what happened to the man and his machine, but I think they were probably both destroyed within a day or two of our conversation. The Germans came fast and strong. There were stories of our soldiers armed with lances, riding against the German tanks on horseback. I do not think the stories were true, but I know that after a week, the war was largely over for us. Or, rather, the fighting was over. The war went on much longer. Parts of me are still fighting it. The Russians came from the north and east, and the Nazis from the west. I lived in a village close to the Czech border, surrounded by green forests. Some of the men from our area, including soldiers who had not been killed in the initial onslaught, were taken to work in the Stoda factories in Pilsen. But Jews like us were considered incapable of such work. At first, it was just strange. And for a few days, it seemed that Mama, Papa, Ishmael, and I were the only people still living in the village, watched over by hundreds of German soldiers. I am sure my parents were very frightened, but they hid it as best they could. My brother and I were more confused than we were scared. Children, I think, are tougher than adults realize. Children adjust. In our case, we lived for days, weeks, I'm not sure. We had mainly hunger and isolation to complain of. Things changed when we had to leave the house we had lived in all our lives. But even as we were packed onto the train to Krakow, Papa managed to make it feel like an adventure, a kind of holiday. It wasn't, of course. It was a version of hell. Poverty and want are one thing in the country, but they are something entirely different in a city, particularly when you are packed into a few square blocks with thousands of others, many of whom were in worse condition than we were. I was still under 12 years of age then, so I did not have to wear an armband, and I remember feeling a peculiarly childish and conflicted form of shame at this. I was embarrassed for my parents and brother, who wore the yellow star, and relieved that I did not have to wear it. But I also carried a deeper, more insidious self-loathing, because I was not standing with them. These feelings only deepened when my brother and I were taken away. Ishmael was 3 years older than I, a strong and solid boy who knew more than he confessed to me about what was happening in our corner of the world. He had black hair and high cheekbones in a pale face, with eyes as dark as pools at night. I idolized him, and he, for his part, protected me. "This will be over soon, little Jersey," he told me every night. "You see if it won't. And when the Germans run screaming from the British bombers, you and me, we'll chase them out, laughing at the tops of our lungs." But the British didn't come. The war went on. And though the Russians changed sides, nothing changed in Poland. It became impossible to remember things that had ever been different, or imagine that the world would ever go back to what it had been. I saw it in my mama's eyes,
in her drawn, haggard face, and in my father's slow watchfulness when he looked at us. His life had been ambushed, redirected, and it would never get back to what it should be. My parents worked long hours in a munitions factory, coming home exhausted, their hands red from the chemicals. We had been in the Krakow ghetto almost a year when the trucks came. They arrived early one morning in March. It was bitter cold, but everyone crowded into the square to see what was going on, in case there was food or other supplies. But the trucks were empty, except for the guards. They were there to make selections for labor camps, packing 8 men into the back of each truck. My family hid, but when they came the next day, and the day after that, we began to wonder if the camps could be worse than where we were living, huddled with another family, and what had once been a tool shed in someone's garden. The walls were a single plank thick, and even with every blanket and coat we owned, the nights were unendurably cold. There was no toilet, no running water, and precious little food. One night, after a tiny meal of potatoes and pig fat, shared with 2 other families, our stomachs achingly hollow, my brother decided he had had enough. "At least in the labor camps, they'll feed us," Ismail urged that night, speaking to me in a hoarse whisper as we lay huddled for warmth. "I can't stay here any longer. I'll go mad. I'll go work and get fed. Then I'll come back. I'm not afraid of work. It has to be better than here." It did not occur to him, or to me, that we would not be brought back to our families. I often wonder if my father overheard us. He said so little those days that it wasn't always easy to tell whether he was awake or when he was asleep. The following day, when the trucks came, Ismail pushed to the front. He was, as I said, a big boy for his age, almost a man, and one of the officers spotted him immediately. "My brother, too," he insisted, pulling me forward through the throng. The officer looked me over disparagingly, but shrugged. He didn't care who they took. I remember looking across the square, sorting through the anxious, drawn faces for my mother or father, but couldn't see them. I never saw them again. Within months, the ghetto was purged. Many were killed in the streets. Others were herded onto trains and packed off on their one-way journey to Auschwitz. We knew none of this. The full scale of it didn't register for years. The horror of the so-called final solution was unimaginable to us. Even now, when I read about it, I find myself wrestling to visualize the enormity of the thing, even though I lived through it. Everyone knows the big number, 6 million dead. But that is not a figure the mind grasps easily. I suspect that for some, when placed in the context of the war, and the length of time it all took, and the sheer geography of it all, 6 million dead seems somehow, I don't know, ordinary, understandable. Certainly, it is a kind of abstract knowledge, a fact without faces. But the terrible mathematics get worse when you think small. At Belzec, at its busiest, Jews were unloaded from train cars at a fake railway station building, where they were stripped and their belongings confiscated, before being escorted into buildings for showers, 200 at a time. They were then gassed with carbon monoxide, or Zyklon B. The process took about 30 minutes. Afterwards, dentists removed any gold teeth from the corpses with hammers, collecting as much as 2 cupfuls for melting. The bodies were buried in shallow graves, but the smell was said to carry for 10 miles, so cremation became the order of the day. At Auschwitz, the ovens burned constantly, consuming 1,000 bodies a day. Somewhere among all those corpses were my parents. I didn't know it for certain for another 2.5 years, but the sense of something lost hung over Ismail and me the very first night we were away from them. The trucks carrying my brother and me had left the city behind and rumbled on into the mountains, heading southwest towards the Czech border. Familiar ground for us, so that in spite of our exhaustion, our hunger, and our uncertainty, we felt the thrill of returning to land we had known as children before the war. We looked at each other, grinning madly for the first time in months, as we peered through the window slits in the truck walls and saw hills and church towers we knew. It was only when the sun began to set that we realized how far we had come and how unlikely it was that we would be going back to Krakow and our parents any time soon. I asked the guard, speaking in my faltering German, the one talent I had been able to use for my family, when we would go back, and he just sighed, almost as miserable to be there as we were.
"Wenn der Krieg vorbei ist," he said,
"when the war is over." We slept in bunks and canvas tents. It was cold, but no worse than it had been in the ghetto. Ishmael was wrong about the food. That first night, we were given a small piece of black bread and a fragment of cheese, and told it was to last us until lunchtime the following day. Ishmael was first incredulous and then furious at how stupid we had been to volunteer for something so awful. He shouted at a guard and said that we wanted to go back to Warsaw. The soldier struck him on the side of his head with the butt of his rifle, and Ishmael fell heavily to the ground, unconscious. As I knelt over him, weeping, a spider-thin man, a fellow Jew, crouched beside me and put his hand over the swelling bruise on my brother's temple.
"That was a stupid thing to do," he remarked. "If you want to survive for any length of time here, you and your idiot brother will learn to keep your mouths shut."
"Will he be all right?" I asked.
"He'll have a hell of a headache when he comes around, but yes, I think so. Unless he does it again. You don't get second chances here. And to make the point so that you both remember it, I'm going to eat his cheese."
He did so, sourly and without relish. But I was too drained by our predicament to muster any real outrage.
"Where are we?" I managed. "They call it the Wenceslas Mine," he said. "What will we do here?" "It's a mine," he said bitterly. "We dig."
But that, as we learned over the next few awful days, weeks, and months, was only partly true. We dug and tunneled, but we also built, pouring concrete and pushing the wheelbarrows of rubble out until our hands bled and we couldn't stand. We toiled beneath the earth like moles, constructing we knew not what. And sometimes we wept for those we had lost, and for what we had become. That there was more to come, stranger and more hideous than anything we had seen so far, we could not have imagined. 6. Alan, Camp Leatherneck Marine, Helmand Province, Afghanistan. He had debriefed after missions 100 times. He knew the drill. And usually, nothing fazed him. This time was different. This time, he felt the weight of shame and confusion, and with them came the long tale of dread. Major Alan Young was a Marine pilot, to the very marrow of his bones. That identity was encoded in his DNA. It was who he was, and he felt it ending, and there was nothing he could do to stop that from happening. The damage was done. He had filed his report the moment he landed at Leatherneck, thankful for the armed escort that had carried him away from Barry's towering rage at the landing strip. The MARSOC team had lost 3 men in the barrage from the helicopters. 4 survivors had to be stretchered out, and 2 of them were in surgery with shrapnel wounds. Alan's fault. It wasn't, of course. He knew that with his head, but in his gut, his failure burned like hot metal. Almost as bad was knowing that the more he tried to explain what had happened, the more he would jeopardize his position.
Mechanical failure was one thing, but coming under the influence of an unidentifiable object? That would blow his career in a heartbeat and land him in the psych ward. He had already decided to say nothing about it, to make it sound like he'd just had a weapons malfunction due, perhaps, to a software glitch, one which, of course, was now fixed and undetectable. Alan chewed his lower lip, his one nervous tick. The moment the bogies had opened fire, the strange glowing sphere had vanished, streaking upwards at unimaginable speed and vanishing into darkness. Their work done, the enemy helos had vanished over the hills, winking in and out of radar like ghosts before the Nighthawks could engage them. If anyone had seen the strange object in the sky, they weren't saying. The debriefing building, a sensitive compartmentalized information facility, SCIF for short, was a low cluster of offices plastered in desert yellow. The operations command team was familiar. Two lieutenants and a captain, who Alan had seen routinely for months, though today they were stiff, formal, and reluctant to make eye contact. He felt like he'd been called to the principal's office, something he hadn't felt since his first days at MCAS Cherry Point. Under other circumstances, it might have been funny. But it wasn't. He'd filed his report immediately following the mission. The duty officers had sent him back to his quarters to rest while they reviewed the details, ordering him to return at 0900. He'd slept badly, playing and replaying the events of the night in his head, looking for something that might plausibly explain what had happened that night over the mountains. In his report, he'd said that the weapon systems had failed, and that he'd been temporarily blinded by a bright light. Perhaps it had been some kind of flare launched by one of the enemy helicopters, or some new kind of drone designed to illuminate the target area, there simply to light the position, and his problems in the Harrier were unrelated. If it was equipment failure, he would know soon enough, because the ground crew was going over his bird to determine what went wrong. They would have a preliminary report by morning, maybe sooner. Alan considered this as he shaved. His blue-green eyes were bloodshot with tiredness, the sockets shadowed, his always lean face looking more than usually drawn and hollow. "You look like hell, Major," he observed. He ran his hands through his short brown hair, noting the way it was graying at the temples, then hurried to the skiff, hoping to God he didn't meet anyone who might ask how things had gone. But everyone would know. You didn't lose three of your own without the whole base knowing. "Please be seated, Major Young, sir," said the intel officer, closing the door behind him. "I'm Captain Thwaite. We've met before." "About 100 times, thought Alan. "Captain," he said. "And this is Lieutenant Jonah," the captain continued, nodding to the woman sitting next to him, who did not look up. "And Lieutenant Simmons," the burly officer by the door. No one was smiling. Alan nodded and took the proffered seat. The captain's formality bothered him. The intel guys were always careful. But this was different. There was an air of caution that suggested everyone was covering their ass. Alan's heart sank. He could be reliving last night's fiasco for months, possibly even years, in depositions and reports and interviews. Captain Thwaite opened a manila folder, rotated it, and pushed it across the table towards him. "This is your account of the events last night," he said. "Before we start, I just want to be clear. We're looking for a clear picture of what happened, putting your account together with the data gathered from drones, AWACS, satellite surveillance, and other witness accounts. No one is accusing you of anything, and your record, which is exemplary, is duly noted. Is there anything you would like to add to the report you've already made? Or change?" The hesitation between those last two sentences had been only a fraction of a second, but it was loaded with meaning. "No, Captain," he said. Another pause, icy despite the still mounting heat of the day. "Nothing at all? Are you sure about that, Major Young?"
asked the lieutenant opposite him. He considered her question for a half second. Alan had seen her, a week ago, at an off-base restaurant frequented by a British regiment. She had looked, as much as possible in her multicam utility uniform, glamorous, sexy even, in makeup that pushed the limits of what was considered acceptable. She had seemed lighthearted, even a little flirty then. There was no trace of that playfulness now, though she had the decency to avoid his gaze when he said, "No, Lieutenant, I stand by my report." The captain produced another document, slightly dog-eared. He considered it thoughtfully and edged it towards Alan, moving as if in slow motion. "This is the preliminary report on your aircraft, from an examination conducted in the early hours of this morning," he said. "A test pilot will take the plane up later today to do further live tests on its weapon systems. But as you can see, the first pass engineering report says that all systems seem to be operating normally. The flight data recorders show no record of any attempt on your part to engage said systems during the mission last night. Can you offer an explanation for that?" "No, Captain, I cannot," said Alan. "Though the loss of power to the systems, which I outlined, would explain why there's no record of the attempt to deploy. It was offline." "That would be the Sidewinder you say you attempted to launch at the enemy helicopter?" said the captain. "Yes. The LGBs worked perfectly. The systems only went down when the helicopters appeared. You think they were somehow jamming you?" "I don't know, Captain. But I think that possibility should be thoroughly examined," said Alan, opting for the same formal professionalism as his interrogators. "I doubt my launch systems failing at the exact time the 35 showed up is a coincidence." "Yes," said the captain levelly. "I would agree. Though I'm unsure of any system that could affect your weapon systems, but not your flight controls." Alan shifted in his chair. He could feel the heat rising in his face. They said they weren't accusing him of anything, but there was more than confusion in the room. There was skepticism. The lieutenant silently moved another sheet of paper in front of the captain. They did not look at each other, but Alan felt that the action had been discussed, planned. Something was about to happen. "Do you recall what you said over the radio last night, Major?" said the captain, looking up. "Not word for word," Alan began, but the captain waved the rest away. "Of course not, Major," he cut in. "But do you recall saying, and I quote, 'I have an unidentified bogey in visual range. Configuration unknown. I think it's disrupting my weapon systems.' Do you recall saying that?" Alan stiffened. "I think what I meant was," he began, but again, the captain interjected. "Do you recall saying that, sir?" "Not precisely." "Are you doubting the accuracy of the cockpit voice recorder?" the lieutenant chimed in. "No," Alan said quickly. "I just don't recall using those exact words." "Well," said the captain, managing a mirthless smile, "I can assure you, Major, that you did, and I'm wondering what you meant by them." "Well, as I said," Alan began, "I was wondering if maybe something on the helicopters." "But you don't say helicopter," the captain pressed. "You say unidentified bogey, configuration unknown, singular. So it seems you weren't referring to the three helicopters." He let the sentence hang in the air. Alan said nothing. "Did you see another aircraft last night, Major, other than the three helicopters you failed to engage when requested to do so by your ground team?" Alan felt cornered, and he had to fight down the urge to come out fighting. There was nothing he could say that wouldn't make the situation worse. "I feel like I need legal counsel or something," he said. "This is a routine debriefing, not a court of law, Major," said the lieutenant. Alan's lip buckled into a derisive smile. There was nothing routine about what was happening this morning. But then there'd been nothing routine about last night, either. He considered. It wasn't their fault that they had to probe him to get a sense of what really happened. If another pilot had told him the same story, would he have believed it? Probably not. He would have guessed that this was some trumped-up horseshit
to cover some more shameful failure. Panic, incompetence, even cowardice. These were the words floating in his interviewers' heads. Ugly words which, if they found their way out of their heads and into any formal account of last night's debacle, would cost him his career at very least. "I did everything I could," he said. It was true, but it sounded lame and desperate. In that instant, Alan knew he had made a mistake. He should tell him everything. Let the chips fall where they may. Maybe the AWACS had picked up some anomalous signal which they had examined more closely, if he said exactly what he thought he had seen. His silence was making his situation worse. "Why don't we take a break and reconvene this afternoon?" said the lieutenant. "You can think things over. We can talk to the survivors from the ground force. Get the test flight completed, and then we can talk later. See if we can connect these dots better." The survivors. Alan nodded. "For the record, Major," said the captain, "Flight Command has asked that you remain grounded until our investigation is concluded. Until tomorrow, then. Major, would you wait here, please?" His debriefers left the room, and for a moment, Alan just sat there, wondering what the hell he had been thinking. Maybe if he went after them, told them he wanted to change his story, this might all start making some kind of sense. He got to his feet, but before he could get to the door, it opened, and a man came in. He was middle-aged, lean and fit-looking, wearing a trim charcoal-colored suit in spite of the desert heat. "My name is Special Agent Martin Hatcher," he said, opening a folding wallet and slapping it onto the table so that the three letters printed on the card inside could be read. CIA. "I'll be taking over this interrogation." "This is a Marine Corps matter," Alan said. "You have no authority." But Martin Hatcher was inflappable. "NCIS are aware of my presence," he said. "I can wait if you'd like to call your superiors," he remarked, moving around the table until he faced Alan, sitting in the captain's former seat. "But that will only waste everybody's time, and you'll still find that I have all the authority I need." His tone was conversational, his manner professional but pleasant, as if what he was doing was ordinary. Today's business, a minor shift from normal operations. Alan stared at him, saying nothing. "Major Young," he went on, taking an envelope from his briefcase, "I have something requiring your immediate signature." He opened the envelope and offered Alan a single sheet of paper, a neatly typed letter addressed to Alan's commanding officer. The first sentence read, "I, Major Alan Young, do hereby resign my commission in the Marine Corps, effective immediately." Alan looked up. The CIA officer gave him a level stare, then plucked a ballpoint pen from his shirt pocket and held it across the table. "Now, please, Major," he said. 7. Jennifer. London. It took Jennifer 3 days to get back to London. She had to bribe 2 different sets of South African traffic cops en route to Johannesburg Airport. They could spot a rental a mile off and tailed you until they saw something they could claim as an infraction, usually someone straying over the solid line dividing the highway. Normally, she was painstakingly careful and alert to police presence, but she was driving in a furious fog that seemed to thicken with each mile the more she considered her father's typically high-handed bullshit. It was so like him, meddling, subverting what she did, what she worked for, what she believed in. She had called once, leaving an angry voicemail that said she was on her way, but refused to say when she'd arrive. The call completed, she had turned off her phone and stowed it deep in her luggage so that she couldn't be tempted to try to reach him again. What she had to say would wait until she was standing in front of him, and she had spent most of her journey crafting in her head precisely what those words would be. On the outskirts of the Johannesburg, skirting a black township edged with rusty corrugated iron and shelters made of oil barrels and polythene sheeting, she moved into the center lane to avoid herds of wandering cattle and goats.
I still had to brake hard when a baboon ran across the road through heavy traffic. She was inside of the city's metropolitan sprawl, but it still felt like what her father considered third world. And people like him made it so. She didn't hate her father. She was sure of that. But of late, it had become harder to distinguish the man from his work. And there was no question that she had hated his work for a long time. Edward Quinn was a financier. That was how he introduced himself, saying it with a modest twinkle that implied he could, with a click of his mouse, bring half a dozen small nations to the brink of bankruptcy. But it wasn't a big deal. If money made the world turn, then it was people like her father who controlled how fast it turned. And while she could live with the sickening profits he reaped in the process, she'd learned, as a child, to loathe the idea that channeling money to one place meant taking it from somewhere else. The tasteful excess she had grown up with, the sprawling Hampstead mansion, the Tuscan villa, the scattering of elegantly appointed apartments and hotel suites in every corner of the world, the Jaguars and BMWs, her father's Savile Row suits, which cost more than most people in Swaziland made in a year. It had all become emblematic of everything that was wrong with the world. For years now, she had vacillated between her moral outrage at the source of her father's wealth and the idea that she could put some of it to good use, despite the harm his corporate cronies had done to the world. But she was off balance now. His meddling in her work couldn't go on. She would sit him down, look him in the eye, and tell him. She was tired of being held hostage. She wanted no more of his money. Ever. The irony that she had used her father's credit card to buy an airline ticket, first class, was not lost on her. Life was about to get very difficult. It would be some time before she could get back to the kind of work she saw as her calling, her cosmic duty to balance the damage her father had done to the world. People managed, she told herself, as she boarded the British Airways flight to Heathrow. She was educated, accomplished. She would be able to find work, good benevolent work, that paid enough that she could cut her ties to her father, and still put enough bread on the table to get by. It would be an adjustment, but she could do it. If it meant losing her fiscal safety net, it also meant she would gain her independence. She extended her pod-like recliner all the way back, reveling in its luxurious privacy, comfortable knowing this was the last time she would do so. From here on, Jennifer Quinn would fly coach, and rarely. She landed shortly after dawn, on a typically cold, damp English morning. She felt strange returning to her past, considering all that she had gained and lost since she was last home. Maybe she would go for a run in the rain after she got home, clear her head. She normally ran every other day without fail, and the cramped confinement had left her body feeling like a compressed spring. She had not left her flight details on his voicemail, so he wouldn't be able to send a car to get her. Her plan was to take a series of trains and buses, like an ordinary person. So she was surprised to see Reg Deacon, her father's personal assistant, waiting for her just beyond customs and immigration. For a second, she watched the man her father called his old retainer, as he scanned the faces of passengers emerging from customs and immigration, with something like contempt. Then her surprise at his being there at all deepened and grew more complicated. Deacon was a chief of staff, and his duties spanned a range of possibilities, both domestic and professional. They did not, however, include chauffeuring. Deacon was in his early 60s, a tough, unreadable man, who had ghosted Jennifer's entire life, but who gave little away. As a girl, she had liked him, but she had distanced herself from him more and more over the years, seeing him as another cog in her father's great machine. This morning, he looked tired, drawn, and there was something in his face she had never seen before.
Then the man's eyes found her and locked on. A flash of recognition was immediately replaced with a kind of sigh as his body sagged, his face hollowing, his eyes full of sadness and apprehension. Something had happened. Something bad. For a moment, they just stared at each other, oblivious to the milling travelers, and something passed between them. Jennifer's anger evaporated in the sudden, absolute, certain realization that her father was dead. And then the world went away, and she was not aware of herself enough to be amazed by her own tears. Deacon had brought her a cheese and onion pastry for breakfast, because she had loved them when she was a kid. Sitting in the car parked outside of Heathrow's Terminal 3, she took a half-hearted bite, and then, though it tasted of nothing, devoured it hungrily, washing it down with a bottle of orange juice. "Now, before we go home," said Deacon carefully, floating that last word.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.